Sand Sharks, everybody.
So I watched the TNA pay-per-view here tonight, and it was over, and you were working on the newsletter, and I was mildly annoyed because you were, you know, later you do that, later I do this, and later I get home. But then I found John Carpenter's The Thing on television, and I was fine. If you had been up for 2 hours and I watched that movie, I probably would have been okay with it.
Now you tell me. I didn't even finish the newsletter.
That's a great, great, great movie. And then we turned it off to watch Sand Sharks. It was not as good as The Thing. All right, so Sand Sharks opens, and there's two guys on, like, BMX dirt bikes. They're driving around in the sand. And then one guy has a bike brakes, won't start, and his friend can't hear him. And then we don't really see much of what happens, but a sand shark comes out of the sand and eats him. And his friend comes up over the ridge. He looks down. And he sees the helmet sitting there empty, and he sees the flag of the bike sticking out. And he goes down to see what's happening, and then he realizes that there's a sand shark there. He tries to get on his bike and drive away, but the shark drags him down or runs him down. And then we get a shot of the sand shark dragging him across the beach screaming.
Could you say sand shark any more nonchalantly? Let's explain to the people what a sand shark is.
Okay.
Because there's no such thing.
I think technically there is, but it's not at all like what they have in this movie. There's a sand tiger shark. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
Well, I'll find out while you explain what a sand shark is to everyone.
Well, it is. No, there are in fact sand sharks. But they're not like this movie. What a sand shark is a weird-looking mutant shark that can swim through sand. Sometimes it can swim really fast and catch up to a motorcycle. Sometimes it swims really slow and it can't catch up to people on foot. And then sometimes it comes diving out of the sand, eats a person, and then just dives right back under the sand. And there's a point here where they explain something about how the shark's skin can, like, absorb the sand and pass it out to the other side, and that's how it swims through it. There's nothing to explain the incredible displacement of sand that would be necessary for this to happen. They would have been better off, like, in Two-Headed Shark Attack, where they just said, there's a shark, it has two heads, and that's it. That's the story. They would have been better off just saying, these sharks can swim through sand.
Sand shark, there is such a thing as a sand shark, but it's actually just the name of a type of shark that lives in the water. Not the sand.
Right.
Yeah. But these sharks swam in sand. That's why they were called sand sharks.
You don't listen to anything I say, do you?
No, I was listening, but I wanted to make sure that it was simplified.
All right. So, there's a character in the show named Jimmy Green. Jimmy Green was played by Corin Nemec, who was once the star of a fantastic television show called Parker Lewis Can't Lose. This movie is not as good as Parker Lewis Can't Lose, and Parker Lewis has gotten old.
He's 41 now.
He was a teenager then, and he's 41 now.
He's a hero in this movie. He was fantastic.
So he's returning to town. He's kind of explained what has happened. What his past is explained in pieces throughout the movie. It's revealed. But the gist of it is that the last time he was in town, he threw a party on the beach. There was a terrible shark attack. Many people died, and so he was run out of town. Now he's returned. Back at the beach, there's two cops, one of whom is, who'd you say it was?
Scott Walton.
Scott Walton, yes. They find a head on the beach.
A head.
A human head. And, Scott Walton says, we've got to explore every angle if we're going to solve this murder. And they're discussing what may have happened. They're afraid to even mention the word shark because of what happened so many years before. And so they determine perhaps a coyote bit his head off.
A coyote.
Yeah.
He's discussing this, by the way, with a female cop who is Jimmy Green's ex.
Yeah, it's Scott Walton's sister and Jimmy Green's ex, yes.
Yeah.
Her name is Brenda.
Small town.
Yeah. It's an island. They did not specify where this was. It's implied it's off the coast of California.
I thought it was off the coast of Florida.
They mentioned the Pacific.
I guess you're right.
Yeah. Good enough, Florida. It's sand sharks. It doesn't really matter. So Parker Lewis explains to his dad, who's the mayor, that he wants to have another party on the beach.
I think it'd be funnier in the course of this movie if, in fact, this took place in Florida, but they kept referencing the Pacific Ocean.
Sure.
Yeah.
So they call Brenda, the sister cop. She calls Dr. Powers, who helped her out the last time they had a shark attack. Brooke Hogan answers the phone.
Dr. Powers.
Yeah. Well, I believe his name is Jack Powers, but Brooke says he's not there. The message is that he has passed on, probably eaten by another shark.
Was her first name Sandy?
Sandy Powers.
Sandy Powers.
That's Brooke Hogan's character.
A doctor.
Yeah.
Dr. Sandy Powers.
And the first thing we saw of this doctor was her walking across a skywalk or something, just specifically so she could walk at the camera and jiggle her boobs.
Mm-hmm. No nudity in this film.
No.
Very disappointing.
There was a tease of nudity too.
Yeah. Then
fucking sharks ruined it.
Eaten.
Yeah. Back at the beach, a girl is mad at her boyfriend for forgetting their anniversary, and so she has buried him up to his neck in the sand. He is bitching, so she puts a hat on his face so he can't see. At that point, there is a roar, and she disappears. He shakes the hat off his head. He looks at the wet red spot where his girlfriend used to be. So she was swallowed whole, right?
Yeah, that's the indication.
The same animal then apparently begins to nibble on him.
Well, it was satisfied after eating a whole body, so then it could just start to nibble.
Yeah, that's what happened. It nibbled him, and he kind of said, ow, ow, and then he started screaming, and then he was sucked under the sand, and that was it.
I can't understand why there were no boobies in this movie, because it got a R rating.
Did it?
Yeah. For some bloody creature violence, it says.
Well, there was a lot of that.
So if you
there was a lot of that.
If the movie's rated R, then let's have some boobies here.
I would have no problem with that.
Plot keywords. Sand, beach, ocean, shark, island.
All true.
In case you're searching.
Check, 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 and check. So Parker Lewis met with some people, and I had no idea what was going on here, except one of the girls was his lawyer. Actually, that was what I wrote down at the time. By the end, it kind of made sense. Parker Lewis, in his travels away from wherever this place was called, he had run into trouble with the mob, and he owed them some money, and if he didn't get money, he was in big, big trouble. And this woman was his mob contact. So they go to the beach. They're making plans for the event. The cops are there, and Parker Lewis and his crew are there. And there's just a girl and her boyfriend wakeboarding in the surf. And Scott Walton says, 15 people died the last time you threw a party. And after he says this, the next cut... They cut to the guy wakeboarding, and less than a second later, a monstrous sand shark emerges and devours him.
Mm-hmm.
This movie is awesome.
There's a lot of devouring.
So much devouring. Sharks are hungry, it turns out. So the girl comes running up to the cops and says, that thing ain't my boyfriend, and the girl and the cops go running back to the beach. There's a gratuitous ass shot in her bikini, and... I'm a bit confused on this point because another sand shark emerged and ate her.
Mm-hmm.
But no one until much later seemed to realize there was a sand shark. I guess they thought this shark came out of the water.
Yes, it's very close to the water.
I see.
Yeah.
Because upon we at home, I guess maybe it's just that I had seen the other sand sharks.
Sure.
Point is, this woman gets eaten, and Parker Lewis and his lawyer determined that this will be bad for business. And they turn and they leave. So, we get the panicked town hall meeting straight out of Jaws. The sheriff explains that in the last shark attack, he had lost his wife and child. He puts a bounty on the shark.
A bounty on the shark?
Actually, Parker Lewis put the bounty on the shark. The sheriff insisted that the beaches are closed. This is going to kill everyone's business. So, I forget what his name was in this movie, but he is Quint from Jaws. He shows up and he says he will catch the sand shark. But not for 1,000, he'll do it for 10. Yes, and this guy, by the way, he knows they are sand sharks.
Robert Pike Daniel? Yes, it is.
All right.
Robert Pike Daniel.
He tells them that they are sand sharks, and he's been hunting them, and he can take care of them. He's the one guy who knows what's going on.
Is he really in Jaws?
No. There's a... This scene was ripped off from Jaws. His character was ripped off from Jaws.
I was confused.
No.
Do you know what his name was in this film?
I want to say Murphy.
His name was Angus.
Angus. They said Angus. That's right.
Angus McSorley.
That's an excellent name.
Yes.
That's an NXT name waiting to happen right there.
Angus McSorley.
Angus McSorley.
And by the way, did you mention that Mayor Greenberg was played by Edgar Allan Poe the Fourth?
I forgot to mention that part.
Edgar Allan Poe the Fourth.
Yeah.
Now I need to find out if that's really the Fourth.
I don't know. I looked him up on IMDb. He's been acting for a long time. It's possible. So we had two guys going out in a shark hunt. It's awesome because they're in literally knee-deep water, and the shark swims underneath them, and they see it. And they panic, and they go running on the shore, but of course it's a sand shark, so they're not safe there, and they get ate. They put up, clear the beach signs everywhere, and Parker just takes them down. Brooke has found a shark tooth in one of the victims. She compares it to the tooth of a prehistoric shark. So Parker Lewis had a plan. He knew that the beaches have been closed due to shark attack. So, just like in Jaws, he needs to supply another shark that's been caught to throw the authorities off the scent. So he called his friends in the movie-making business. And it turns out his friends in the movie-making business had been making a shark movie in which actual sharks were used.
Real sharks.
Yeah.
They ate someone and had to be shot.
Yes.
That was the story.
Yes. How did Lance not like this?
This did not fool Brooke Hogan.
No. She examined it, says the wrong shark. It's also been dead for a week. So, Jimmy's got his tech guy working on the various power feeds and camera feeds and whatever, and the shark eats the internet, or one of them does. So the power goes out. So everyone...
Which, by the way, an awesome graphic of the lights going out over the town. They took a photo of the town.
That's actually later, but yes.
And slowly darkened it piece
by
piece.
It looked like this one cord going out had knocked out all the power in the state of California. But yeah, so everyone goes down and meets at the beach, and the cops are there, and Parker and his crew, and the mayor, who is Parker's dad, and Brooke Hogan's there, and they're all kind of yelling at each other, and Scott has Parker's friends. She's holding them at gunpoint for whatever reason, and Brooke is by herself out in the sand, and she sees the big fin is starting to circle here, and she is scared, and somehow they see the shark, but it doesn't eat her, and they get her back to the asphalt, and apparently these sharks that can swim through sand cannot penetrate concrete.
Well, that makes sense.
No, they're not concrete sharks. So they're safe there, and I already talked about how they stole the scene from Jaws. Here they steal the scene from Deep Blue Sea. When the mayor goes up and he stands on the asphalt with his back to the sand, he's making a big speech about how he's going to protect the town and save everyone, and then one of the sand shark pops up and eats him.
Eats him.
And to which Parker replies, quote, "My dad, it went, and it ate him."
My dad! It went, and it ate him, and he's gone!
Oh my God.
And then they do the scene where, yes, Sparky is the guy's name. He's trying to hook the power back up, and just as he plugs the big giant cord back in, a sand shark devours him. This explodes the shark, but it also knocks out all the power, perhaps on the entire West Coast. So, they now think there was a sand shark, but it blew up, so we're okay now.
It's now dead.
So Jimmy is going on with the plans for his party. And that's going on. Brooke explains to the sheriff that, she's a fish doctor. Or a marine biologist.
Something like that.
Yeah. So she says, this shark that we blew up, it was a newborn. And Mama's going to come looking for it. So we get the party on the beach. The saddest looking party I ever saw.
This was awesome.
It's Parker Lewis in his 40s with a microphone.
The story was that he is trying to save the town, you see.
Yes.
By having their version of Burning Man, for example.
Yeah.
And this one day a year is going to bring in enough revenue to take care of them for 365 days.
Yes.
So this party, they have like, I swear to God, 30 extras.
No more.
And they get a tight a shot as they can, but you could still tell there's only 30 of them. And they're just kind of bouncing up and down, yeah, so their boobs jiggle.
You can tell they put in music afterwards in editing, and they said, okay, everyone, we don't have any music, just dance.
Sure.
And so everyone just kind of shimmies around randomly.
Yeah.
This party sucks.
It's amazing.
Yeah. So Parker goes back to his... Oh, his dad, by the way. Parker dedicated this party to his dad in front of everyone. His father, who he had witnessed being devoured not 24 hours prior.
Sure. He's over it.
Yeah. So he goes back to his trailer. The mob lawyer is there. She kisses him. As she kisses him, Brenda walks up and she witnesses this and she is heartbroken again. So she storms off and Parker says to go after her and the lawyer yells at Parker and he yells at her. And as they're having this fight, suddenly she is swallowed whole by a sand shark. Not whole. Excuse me. Most of her is swallowed by a sand shark.
Everything but her head.
Her head goes flying through the air and lands under his trailer where they showed what was very clearly a plastic head.
The acting done by, what's the character's name?
Jimmy Green?
Jimmy?
Jimmy Green, yes.
Jimmy Green?
Yeah.
The acting by Jimmy Green in this scene is the best I've seen ever. His reaction to this woman being eaten, everything but her head, right in front of them.
Yeah.
And then immediately everyone starts walking up and he tries to pretend nothing has happened.
Yes.
Because he doesn't want the party canceled.
Right.
And so his shocked freak out when they walk around the corner, followed by laughter to pretend like nothing is wrong.
Yes.
This man is an acting god.
You really are a man-eater, aren't you?
You know why you'll always be in someone's debt, Jimmy? You just don't have the head for business.
Holy shark! Oh, get it again. She's one shark. She's one shark. Oh, show must go on. Show must go on.
He had a great show, then he disappeared, and I don't know what he's done since.
Sand sharks.
Apparently that's it.
He can retire now. So his peak.
His other two assistants show up. There's an intern and his tech guy. And they find the head, and they start screaming. He explains, well, there was this shark that came out of the sand and ate her. And, you know, none of them are concerned that, you know, a shark may come back and eat them. They are very concerned the party does not get canceled. And the only one who is concerned is the tech guy. He's not down with this. He's going to go warn people about the shark. And so the intern closes him over the back of the head with a wrench or something. And she says, you go to the party, I'll take care of this. And she starts dragging the tech guy's unconscious body around. And the sand shark appears, so she just shoves him forward.
And sacrificed.
The shark eats him. And then she goes and hides in the trailer.
Yeah.
So there's some nerds at the party, but they have drugs. And the hot chicks with the big fake tits want the drugs. And so it's implied they're going to show their boobs. But they don't, because sharks attack.
Shark eats them.
And at this point you said, accurately, they're legion! There are sand sharks everywhere.
Everywhere.
People are just dying left and right. It's... Of the 30 people, there's 15 hot chicks, 14 good-looking guys... And one whale of a fat guy, who I don't think got eaten, actually. Which is funny, because, you know, he couldn't run, he was fat. But they're all just running randomly. Not to the water, not to the concrete, just run somewhere. So, Parker, who's been drinking, he tries to save Brenda, because he's always loved her. And he's trying to get her back to the asphalt, but before they can get there, a shark shows up and bites her in half. He's persistent and optimistic. He drags the upper half of her body onto the asphalt, leans her up against the car tire as best he can, and a trooper to the end, he then begins to take bits and pieces of her viscera and put them back into her torso so that perhaps she will live.
If I just put this intestine back,
yes,
she'll be fine.
Yes, it will stay there and she'll live. So he confesses that he has always loved her. She whispers in his ear, we're not sure what she said. I believe it was, you jerk. And then she passes on. So Brooke and Scott end up trapped on rocks on the beach. They call the car, Brenda's car, trying to get her to come help them. Brenda, of course, has passed on. So Parker Lewis gets on the CB there and says, Scott, I don't know how to tell you this, but your sister was bitten in half by a shark.
Yeah. He didn't know how to tell him this.
Scott does not take this news well.
No.
He tears into him, says this is all his fault, just like the last time. So Jimmy steals the cop car to go to the docks, which is where the ferry is, but the ferry's not coming for another day. At this point, Scott and Brooke realize they are trapped on these rocks and there are sand sharks all around them, so they have to call Jimmy back and apologize.
Well, kind of. Scott Walton basically says, you're still under arrest, and I'm still going to kill you, but I need your help.
Yeah. You didn't do it.
No.
And he went to the docks. It was kind of hysterical because the docks crowded with people, and this, like, 30-foot sand shark jumps out of the water, takes a big bite out of the dock, eats four or five people. You cannot possibly miss this.
No.
But they did. And so Parker Lewis shows up, and he's got a megaphone. He's trying to get people to run away, and there's some kids down at the beach, and they get eaten.
So, no, you need to get off the beach right now. You need to get up, and you need to run and get off of the beach because, oh, my God, you guys are idiots.
Don't you got guns in here, brother? And then Angus McSorley arrives.
Angus McSorley.
Yep. He takes over to save the day. So then everyone meets back at the sheriff's office. Scott and Brooke got off the rocks. It's not explained how, and it's acknowledged that it is not explained how.
Yeah. I thought you were stuck on rocks. We got off.
Yep.
Move on.
So.
By the way, Edgar Allan Poe IV is, in fact, the great-grandson of Edgar Allan Poe.
There you go.
And at one point on the film Sabrina, or I guess a TV show, Sabrina the Teenage Witch, he played Edgar Allan Poe.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So Angus McSorley has a plan. He has been tracking these sharks for years. He saw them, he said, diving at the bottom of the sea and knew they'd come to shore eventually. What he wants to do is lure them into one key location, and once they're all in one spot, you heat up the sand and melt it into glass and trap them.
That's his idea.
Yeah. I punched the mic.
Good work.
Thank you. So they determine that they can use the speakers from the party, which is now ruined by the sand sharks. And they can use that to lure them to this patch of sand. And then Jimmy, for reasons that were never explained, is carrying around napalm. And he can use that to melt the glass. So they try this. They start playing Flight of the Valkyries, which is, in fact, Daniel Bryan's music. It works. The sharks go up to the speakers, but then the speaker gets cut. That's not, I guess a shark bit it. So they all start to scatter. So Jimmy's like, I'll go fix it. And they're like, no, you can't. It's too dangerous. And no one says, you know, 30 to 40 people are dead because of you. Because of your selfish, cowardly actions, you have caused multiple deaths. And now if you want to go sacrifice yourself to redeem yourself, you can't. So he does anyway and tries to fix the speakers, but the cords can't be fixed. And so he starts singing, row, row, row your boat, and the sharks follow him. And he manages to sing and run from the beach to wherever the hell they are. And the sharks don't catch him until he gets there. And then he just lays down and they eat him.
They all eat him at the same time.
Yeah. And then Angus McSorley fires out the napalm. He has a flamethrower, and he traps them all in sand. And
a flamethrower.
Yeah, he built one, he said. He said, where'd you get a flamethrower? I built it with parts off of eBay, he said.
Mm-hmm.
So the sharks are all in glass, and they're all happy, and then they all look up on the ridge over their heads, and there's a dorsal fin going by on the ridge, hundreds and hundreds of feet tall. Peeking up to the clouds is this dorsal fin.
Seems like a pretty big shark.
seems like a battleship-sized shark.
Mm-hmm.
So it pops out. It eats Angus McSorley. Scott and Brooke, who are the only two left at this point, they go running into the shed. And just like in Two-Headed Shark Attack, the shark goes into the shed. And this shark, which just prior had been thousands of yards long, is now no bigger than the other sharks.
Yeah.
It fits right in the shed.
Well, this could have been a different shark, actually.
All right.
Because there is at least one other shark.
That's true. Yeah. So
maybe there is a mega shark
for
the sequel.
They finish this shark the way they finish off the shark in Jaws. They get a propane tank into his mouth. They don't have to shoot it. It just blows up on its own. But it blows up, and Scott and Brooke are covered in shark blood and guts. And you think it's the end, And then they go back to the trailer on the beach where the intern has been hiding ever since she shoved the tech guy into the shark's mouth.
Forgot about her, didn't you?
She'd been hiding the trailer the entire time. And she steps out cautiously in the sand. And she takes a phone call. And she somehow knows that Jimmy is dead and she's going to take over his clients. And then a shark pops out of the sand. And we get the shark tongue cam.
Yes.
We are looking out of the shark's mouth at her as it eats her. And that's the end of the movie.
Agnes McSorley, Robert Pike Daniel here, had to have written this bio himself on IMDb. I'm just going to read the first line. A versatile, red-headed actor of veteran status, Robert Pike Daniel has crafted a screen career spanning well over a decade and counting. We are counting the years in the career of Robert Pike Daniel. This movie was 1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, remains the worst movie I've ever seen in my life.
I've seen dozens of movies worse than Sand Sharks.
Sand Sharks was just like, it had a budget. They hired, I thought the acting in this movie was like, maybe I just was spoiled watching this movie because of how bad Two-Headed Shark Attack was. But even Brooke was tolerable.
Yeah. She has more emotions than annoyed.
Yeah. The acting, per shark movie standards, the acting was excellent. They had a budget, except when they didn't want a budget. That's the key. When they wanted it to look low budget and cheesy, they probably used a good deal of money to make it look as bad as possible and cheap.
Yeah.
It had a decent story. It had well-crafted comedy, I felt.
It had a lot of good comedy. It had distinct characters. Maybe not believable characters, but just distinct. There was a plot development. There was a story of redemption in the thing. And most importantly, it did not take itself too seriously. It knew it was crap. It was not going to win an Oscar anytime soon and did not try. So it had scenes where, for example, a woman was eaten by a shark and people saw it and said, that's going to be bad for business, and that was the only reaction. Or a scene where a man tried to take a woman who had been bitten in half and put her guts back together by hand and try to save her life.
I'm actually very disappointed because on Rotten Tomatoes, Sand Sharks, 9% liked it. Really? 91% of people thought this movie sucked? What's wrong with people?
I don't know.
Everyone should be forced to watch Two-Headed Shark Attack.
Yes.
And then watch this movie, and there's no way this is 9% liked it. It's just impossible. Maybe my standards have just really plummeted after Two-Headed Shark Attack. I enjoyed the movie, everybody. I enjoyed this movie. I give it a thumbs up.
Yeah. This is a fun movie.
It was a fun movie.